Hello, every. Now it says it's on air. Cool. Okay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. And we have Vinny Eastwood back with us. And today's topic is desperate measures. The brighter the light of truth shines, the more desperate those in the dark continue to get, with an increasingly comical clusterfuck of airhead stupidity. And this discussion is about those happenings. I mean, you know, we see Obama and his continued, you know, frickin' fails. More people keep waking up. The elites keep getting more and more nervous, and their false flags keep bombing. Everything keeps bombing as they just get more and more nervous. And speaking of nervous false flags and shills, you did share a little video with me about some of your recent experiences. If you want to tell us about that, I know you showed me a video you got up on your channel, and I did watch that, and I downloaded it, and I re-uploaded it to a few other places just in case somebody decides to fraudulently DMCA you again. But yeah, that's really interesting. It was about Pete Santilli, I do believe.
That's right. I just called him Santilli. Can you hear me, Kelso?
Yeah, I can hear you just fine. I'm shutting up to let you talk, if that's okay.
You might want to get some headphones on, bro, because we're getting a little bit of feedback there.
That I will toss on my headphones right now.
I'm glad to see you've learned nothing since our last broadcast about technical issues.
Well, that issue usually doesn't arise until your big mouth blast through my sound system. That's usually the only time I need to take that countermeasure. So, yeah, sorry, I forgot just how big of a mouth you have. Anyway, you were saying.
I get that a lot. Okay, well, I don't know what to say that hasn't been said in the video. You know, I mean, if you just want the really, really short version, the video's 14 minutes. You can go watch that, see all the documents and all the evidence and all the narration and a 30-year history of Pete Santilli screwing people over, stealing their ideas, threatening and harassing them, hijacking movements, and being arrested for crimes, and then inexplicably getting away with these crimes with absolutely no recompense whatsoever. And apart from the fact that we've found out that he's actually working with the FBI. Now, I want to actually address some of the people who've questioned the video and its validity and the facts and all of this other stuff. Now, this video was released only a few days ago, less than 3 days ago. Already it has 4,256 views, 163 comments, 326 likes, and 24 dislikes. All right? And that's after the very first day, me being banned from Facebook, posting this and sharing it around. Everybody else has been doing the sharing for it because it's just that compelling. It's simply my finest work. But during the comment sections, I was really kind of irritated with it, essentially, because you get a whole bunch of these people that are going like, why is a foreigner covering this? Did you think maybe it's because nobody else was freaking going to? Mm-hmm. you know, nobody else has the guts. Nobody else has the intelligence. Nobody else has the commitment in order to expose this one particular scumbag who has hurt so many people over such a long period of time, including myself and many others, that somebody had to do something. And
I think that kind of gives you the right to talk about it, seeing as you are one of the injured parties. So, like, what does it matter that you're a freaking foreigner? You're still one of the injured parties.
You know what's kind of interesting to me? I'm surprised a guy like this, you know, hasn't gotten the attention of some of these major media outlets such as Russia Today, InfoWars, you know, some of the really big media, alternative media out there. I'm surprised that, you know, his attitude and his, you know, his kind of psyop crap that he pulls, I'm surprised that nobody in the bigger alternative media has taken a look at that and said, hey, let's blow this guy's cover.
He's attacked Alex Jones.
Let me just explain something to you guys. Firstly, if you're that big, he's not worth your time. You know, I'm not that big, so and I was still on holiday, so I thought, well, everybody needs a project. So just fucked him. Just fucked him. And the reason why the big guys don't comment is, I think, two reasons. Number one, they're too busy. You know, they're always producing stuff, and quite frankly, every time you come out against a member of the truth movement, doesn't matter whether they're a sociopathic, criminal, scumbag, a rapist, pedophile, lying, filthy kind of scumbag, if they're part of the alternative media, just attacking them and exposing them and telling the truth about them is a big no-no. That's because the entirety of alternative media, and I want you to really listen closely, because this is absolutely true. The entirety of the alternative media is compromised. Okay, we're either too dumb to see the truth, or we're being lied to by a very clever, egomaniacal psychopath with a lust for power and influence, or a number of other reasons. Basically, either the people that you listen to that you trust are either not trustworthy, or they're so dumb that they don't know how dumb they are, and you keep trusting them, even though they're giving you incorrect information the whole time. About 95 to 99% of truth movement figures, most of the people who you would recognize are like that, and the bulk of them are also very dishonest people. However, I wanted to actually get into...
You forgot option three, the one that I've actually seen that's most common, is that each of them have a small piece of any given puzzle, but instead of putting all the pieces together, they think that one piece is all there is, so then they bicker and bitch and dickwag with each other, and if they would actually put that much effort and energy coming together to go after the criminals as they put into arguing over exactly how the World Trade Center fell, we might actually get somewhere.
I disagree. Quantify the human body. How many organs do you have in the entire human body? How many bones? How many breaths do you take per day? How many liters of blood is running through your thing? What is the weight of your urine and stool samples? What is your fertility level? Okay, see, just understanding your own body and its inputs and outputs is an incredibly complex thing, and people are trying to understand the entire world, okay? It's not possible. It's not possible for somebody to have all the elements in the equation and figure the entire planet out. So what an intelligent person does is they begin to specialize. They go, okay, well, the New World Order and the government control structure is actually the thing that I really now begin to understand. But they don't understand, say, the health aspect of it, or they don't understand the covert technology and surveillance blimps and so on and stuff for all that. So they've only got a bit of the picture, as you say. But what that means is, we're all contributing, okay? Mm-hmm. We're all contributing to the global understanding. Each person we wake up to, each topic is one person that has woken up and is no longer a subservient slave, hopefully. However, the large quantity of people that are still listening to Pete Santilli, even after watching that video, suggests to me that his audience are people without any brains, without any conscience, without any morality, right? Now, that is what I want him to be reduced to. Currently, there's a number of smart people who are listening to him. No smart person will watch that video and go, I'm going to keep listening to Pete Santilli. Every idiot, on the other hand, every compromised, pseudo-psychopathic piece of trash, and there are a hell of a lot of them in the truth movement, and I'm not bagging, you know, the truth movement.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, they will be his only audience left. Now, that's my intention, because the reason why Pete Santilli has become so successful, has gotten so big in such a short period of time, is because people that are smarter than him, more talented and harder working than him, have had all of their work siphoned and stolen by him, and he accumulated all that for himself. If you eliminate the intelligent population from ever listening to or supporting him, he will run out of money to steal, he will run out of ideas to steal, and he will run out of people who are intelligent enough to hear what he says and actually do something about it. It'll disable.
Completely agreed. I just don't know how that disagrees with what I said, because all I said is people love to bicker and bitch, and if they would put as much energy into uniting as they do bickering and bitching, they might actually get somewhere.
That's what I said about a lot of the truth movements are idiots, because if they were smart, they would stop bickering and arguing. They'd specialize in something, knowing that it's impossible to understand the entirety of it. All right?
Thank you for establishing that we agree with each other, so moving on.
Exactly. Now, here's a quote from Darboo777. He's got 120,000 subscribers on YouTube, very popular channel, and he commented on the Pete Santelli thing, and I've explained a few things to him, and I want to read this out to you. So, Darboo says, I only questioned the FBI facts. That aside, you dropped bombs, son. Killuminati, it's wartime. And I asked him, do you only question the facts because Santelli said it's fake? And he says, not at all. I feel it may be an out, meaning they made it. That way, when he proves it's fake, it makes others look like fools, making sheep instantly think he's legit once he proved it's fake. But he's not legit. That's how I'm viewing it. Great work, too. And I go, so let me get this straight. The FBI plant fake faxes on all their informants' computers just in case that informant gets hacked by Anonymous and leaks their personal documents. And they do this in order to make sure that people think that FBI informants are FBI informants for a little bit of time, and then once they claim that it's fake, not one single person would ever mistakenly think that they were an FBI informant. And obviously, when you prove the fax is fake, every single person who saw the original fax and thought that it was real would see your broadcast and not question it one little bit. Yeah, is that your logic here, right? How came you by this information? Did you handle informants for the FBI and deliberately plant fake faxes on them? And why only fake faxes? Why only falsely planted communication? Why not emails? You know, what about fake tweets, fake Facebook messages? Do you have any supporting documents, training manuals that illustrate the practice, FBI agent confessions, anything that illustrates a track record of the FBI deliberately putting compromising information on their own covert assets in order to undermine them and their ability to operate below the radar and serve their handlers without drawing suspicion? All right? Because in my experience, if you're committing a crime and want to continue to do so,
and you're not Hillary Clinton.
Sure. The number one rule, and really the only rule, is to stay above suspicion, okay? Because once someone actually proves that that fax is fake, and I've seen a lot of people try, then I'll take this tangent seriously. But till then, the only thing I've seen is people who don't know how to use digital design technology pour over the writing in the facts, making assumptions and deductions about the writing, the use of language, the wording, etc. Not one has spotted a single legitimate discrepancy in either the digital layout of the document or the wording, other than logically fallacious assertions based upon poor logic and weak suppositions. Now, I invite anyone to prove that it's fake. If they have compelling evidence, then that's great. We can stop being wrong. But for now, we have Pete's personal documents, addresses, private information, driver's license, social security cards, his usernames and passwords to his social media accounts. They were all leaked alongside that fax. So to say that the fax is fake, you'd also have to assume that every single other leaked document is also a forgery. And considering all of those documents have been verified by Santelli himself as being legitimate, what makes you think he's telling the truth about the fax? Considering his 30-year track record of never telling the truth about anything.
Not to mention,
I've noticed Anonymous tends to not go after anyone who isn't truly deserving of it.
another thing to consider, I think, with a lot of people who listen to Santelli, there tends to be a lot of that father figure type thing. You know, they like to put. Generally, people I've noticed in the truth movement like to put, you know, notable figures on pedestals, and when any information that's out there contradicts all of the good things that they've heard about someone, they tend to shun it, you know. They don't want to think about it, they want to dismiss it, they don't, you know, they want to push it out there as lies, or all of its lies, you know. I mean, you know, I know with Alex Jones and InfoWars, there are people constantly coming out all the time and saying, oh, well, he's a Mossad agent, or he works for the CIA, or he's, you know, all this inside information, inside intel. And, you know, as far as I'm concerned with him, it's like, so what? He's obviously not, you know, stiffing people and, you know, screwing people over and, you know.
Are you talking about Alex Jones?
Yeah, I'm talking about Alex Jones. I mean,
I actually have to completely disagree with you there. I've spoken to Alex Jones's former producer. I've spoken to his former sit-in radio show host. I've spoken to some of his former financiers. None of them have anything good to say about him, and he has done deliberately deceptive and criminal acts against them. But the person who he committed the biggest criminal act against was a theft of a radio transmitter that was able to reach about 50,000 homes in Austin. They were good friends, and then all of a sudden, that transmitter wasn't playing his show anymore. It was playing Alex's. Right? Now, that's tortious interference with a corporation. That comes with a jail term. But you know why he didn't sue him? Because who wants to go down in history as the person who got Alex Jones sent to prison? Okay, so he doesn't do it. however, now, I personally got awakened by Alex Jones, but it was a couple of years later before I awakened from my awakening by Alex Jones, and I realized that I wasn't wanting to be Alex Jones. I wasn't wanting to say death to the New World Order and toting guns around and things like that. I actually decided that I would care about people, that I would actually listen to them, that I wouldn't interrupt them all the time, that I would get people who are saying crazy stuff, like really amazing, like whoa, kind of things, without trying to put my spin on it, but actually just listen to them and give them a platform, because all of these activists and people that are researching stuff all over there, they do what I consider the real work in the truth movement. They read government documents. These are boring jobs, okay? And I it's a thankless job as well, because nobody gets to hear your research, because they want, you know, to have compelling shows, and they're cut up by all these commercial breaks and things like that. And let's just say that Alex Jones gave me a voice, and because he gave me my own voice, that's when I managed to find myself and realize that I did not need him anymore. And what I wanted to do was fulfill that promise to other people. You want to listen to my show? That's great. But the greatest compliment you could ever pay me as a radio show host is to stop listening and start doing your own thing. Doesn't have to be radio. Doesn't have to be YouTube. It could be inventing a device. It could just be spending a hell of a lot more time taking care of your children so that they don't grow up brainwashed and poisoned by the toxic products that surround them constantly. We can all play a part in the way the future of humanity is going to play out. However, I'm cognizant of the fact that if we all try to copy each other because he's better or he's bigger or anything like that, we compromise our own individuality, which belies the point of stopping a collectivist takeover of humanity.
That's a very good point, Vinny. All I'm saying, though, is whatever you want to say, I mean, about Alex Jones, you said your own bit, and you've got some insider information that I don't have, because obviously you know people, and you've talked in the background, and you've been there and done that. And I'm not saying he's a saint. I'm not saying he's a good guy. I'm not saying that he's, you know, anything to admire or respect, but I will say to his credit, and this is the only thing I will say, he does say quite regularly, and I've heard him say it, you know, he says, don't, you know, follow me or praise me or, you know, worship me. Do essentially what you said, you know, do your own research, go out there and look around. And all I'm saying is, with people who listen to Pat Santilli or whoever the heck you listen to, you know, you're the ultimate judge on discernment. Don't let, you know, these talk show hosts and these big, you know, make alternative media figures be the voice for you. Be your own voice and speak up for yourself and do your own research and, you know, look into the truth that there is, that does exist out there in the real world. You know, don't just rely on some, you know, mainstream talking head for all of your information and take that as gospel. That's all I'm trying to say.
If you let anybody do your thinking for you, you're clearly incapable of thinking for yourself. Okay? And that is dangerous, because that means it doesn't matter who it is, whether they be a moral person or anything, the Lord Acton quote is, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely, and all great men are inherently evil. There's a reason why the third line from that Lord Acton quote is not often quoted along with the rest of it, because throughout the course of history, you will find, if you look into the truth of it, a lot of people that you think are good on the history pages are actually assholes. And a lot of people that you think are evil were actually really nice guys to hang out with and chat with and that kind of thing, but they were still psychopathic killers, right? Anybody who's really, really big, really, really great is inherently evil. And it's just a matter of time before the truth comes out and they show their true colors, because it doesn't matter who you are. I'm corruptible. Everybody is.
The little known Abraham Lincoln quote comes to mind, the one where he admits that if he could have won the war freeing some of the slaves or none of the slaves, he would have done that. That he didn't care one way or the other about the slaves. It's just that freeing the slaves was just a military strategy that he used at the time, and that, you know, Lincoln didn't give two flying shits about the freaking slaves, yet Lincoln is known as the Great Emancipator, which is a complete load of bullshit for anybody who cares to look that up.
Considering the blacks couldn't even vote after he'd allegedly freed them all.
Yeah, and, you know, as far as what you're saying about Alex Jones being, you know, your initial wake-up, it's like he was one of many of my initial wake-ups, too. And in the first incarnation of my YouTube channel, you know, besides talking about metaphysics, quantum physics, all that good stuff, you know, I was too, I think, focused on the, you know, pointing at the, oh, look at what the New World Order's doing sort of stuff. And I didn't really like the crowd that I was really drawing with that. And, you know, now with the new channel, you know, it's like kicking that into gear. I realized that what I really, really, really want to talk about the most is the dichotomies, the mental malware, you know, that we all have and how that works so that we can deprogram ourselves. Mm. Because what can we do if we're not willing to face ourselves and see that maybe we're the cosmic schmuck, as, you know, you've said on a previous episode?
Well, there was Robert Anton Wilson who actually had that quote about the cosmic schmuck. Now, I've popped a link into your Skype there, Kelso. What's it called? Has Alex Jones been exposed, and does it even matter? I go in, that's just an 8-minute video. It's got nearly 10,000 views, but I tell the stories of the people who I knew personally who were involved directly with Alex Jones and the things that he did to them, stealing their advertisers, firing them because they did a good interview, because he was supposed to do the big guests and things like that. Think about one of the most vicious cases of control freak, paranoid megalomania that you could ever conceive of, but also so highly intelligent that they're capable of concealing it from everybody at the same time except one person at a time, so that when that one person who realizes the scumbaggery goes and tells somebody about it, they're like, ah, no, that couldn't be Alex or anything. It's like that, you know, you just sit there and you listen to it. Now, this is the most important thing. It's not so much about the dichotomy. It's about one thing only, putting people on a pedestal. All right. Once you put people on a pedestal, once they come tumbling down off that pedestal, who do you think's going to feel really crushed? You, the dipshit who put them up there, right? Yeah. And they will come tumbling down. Take examples, take characteristics, take behaviors, take actions.
That's why I always say, don't put me or anyone on a pedestal. And I always tell people, whether you're praising someone or you're demonizing them, you're still putting them in a deity position. You know what I mean? It's one thing to have an opinion about someone or to give the facts about someone or whatever.
Well, I disagree. It's one thing to have an opinion about somebody, but it's another thing entirely to have the facts about somebody. All right. In Pete Santilli's case, literally the facts.
Well, all I'm saying is that whether you praise someone or demonize them, when you put that much obsessive energy into them, it's still just two different types of pedestals. It's one coin, two different pedestals, and you're right, when they come tumbling down.
How is that a pedestal? Because a pedestal is something you look up to, you want to emulate. All right.
Well, when you demonize someone, you're still projecting that idea of they have more power than you do. By demonizing, I don't mean admitting that they're a scumbag. That's not what I mean. When I say demonize, like, you know how a lot of people look at, you know, the so-called Illuminati, and they're like, oh, they're gods, they're all powerful, I'm just poor little me. What could I possibly do against that big monster magical demon called the Illuminati, who's so much more bigger and so much more powerful? That's still a pedestal, even though it's a negative pedestal. That's still a pedestal. That's why I always make fun of the elites, and I say they are inbred cousin fucking morons who are incapable of reading without a teleprompter. They probably can't even tie their own shoes unassisted, so they get their power from us. So these are not people that we need to be, you know, viewing as these big unstoppable monoliths.
I completely disagree with the entire premise there. If you're looking at something with the aura of reality and evidence, anybody will look at the New World Order, the current elites, and know that they actually have real power. Not power that we give them, but power they stole from us. We don't just, you know, sit there by consent or whatever. Have a look at all the protesters in the United States who are getting pepper sprayed and getting kicked to the curb. And like in New Zealand here, we have cops who kick 16-year-old girls to the curb who are just standing on the sidewalk watching them bust up a party and knock like four of her teeth out, and not a single cop goes to jail or anything like that. These people have real power, and it is insane to think otherwise. It's absolutely crazy to think that somebody who has nukes, wide masses of surveillance technology, armies of thugs without a conscience, hyped up on drugs and psychopathic behavior, and huge quantities of brainwashed morons, the vast majority of the population who have been forcibly put into school, who have been forcibly indoctrinated into being brainwashed slaves. You think these people, you think the elite have no power? They have the power to control the world. I know this because they currently control it.
The only reason they have the power and the control is because, yet again, they play the psychological manipulation through their machinery, their technology, their military might, their air power, their tanks, their soldiers, their men. They use
the
all
word
of that.
Is full spectrum dominance.
Full spectrum dominance. It's just like what
that's
the
exactly
Nazis.
What it
it's
is.
Just like what the Nazis did. The Nazis did the same exact thing. They did it in, you know, Europe. The Russians did it. You know, the Soviets did it back in Russia. You know, it's the same type of thing, only on a global scale. But yet again,
those movements have been financed by the elites the whole time.
I'm not arguing with who's getting financed by what.
The context is, how long have they been playing this game? Okay, they've been playing this game, as far as I know, as soon as civilization started. Okay, so it's not like, oh, the only reason why they've got this power is because they've been playing the power game since forever, and have only gotten better at it through the course of history. All right, and
I'm not arguing.
We can't go back 2,000 years and go, oh, okay, well, this is their one methodology. We can't even fast forward to today and go, oh, okay, well, this is the one thing, because everybody's trying to figure out the solution to this, and I hear people talking about it all the time, and it pisses me off, right? It actually pisses me off, people thinking that they can solve this, they can come up with one scheme, it'll solve everything. I was talking to one person the other day who goes, oh, I've got the methodology to disarm and disable and disempower every single psychopath on the planet. And I go, really? Really? You've got the ability to stop 1% to 4% of the population who have no conscience, no morality, are capable of lying convincingly, have most of the power and the money in the current society, and you're going to come up with a scheme to just disempower and dethrone all of them simultaneously by your fucking self? I don't think so!
Here's the problem.
We are so dumb that we don't know how dumb we are. That is how we're kept in control, because we're not humble enough to go, hey, these guys actually have a really bright scheme, a scheme that might actually be so complex, so big, and be going for so long that not a single human mind on the planet is capable of comprehending all of it at once in order to come up with a workable, comprehensible solution to all of the full spectrum dominance aspects in which we are dealing. That is why I said in the earlier part, if you are intelligent and you start looking at the New World Order, you will find one aspect that you really understand. Not only do you understand it, but you're capable of making other people understand it. That is how we beat them. We don't go, oh, I'm going to solve everything. We go, I'm going to just work on this one problem, and I'm going to help other people.
Exactly.
The more people who do that, and the reason why I say that is because it's the direct opposite of the way the elite work. The elite go, okay, I want to control everything, so let's fuck up everything. Whereas an ordinary person without too much power or resources will go, man, everything's fucked, but I can unfuck this one little thing right here.
And if you unfuck all the little things at the same time...
No, but it can't be done, because you'd need coordination. You'd need a hierarchical structure. And guess what happens to every single hierarchical structure as soon as it's created? Psychopaths infiltrate and take it over. It is me. It is everybody's choice, individually, to go out and fight against the New World Order. You can't do it together. You can't form your organizations. You can't go and do all of this kind of thing, because every time you want to corrupt a great idea, build an organization around it. That idea will get corrupted in a flash, in a heartbeat. The one thing that's impossible to infiltrate is a one-man operation. One person who's independent, who does all their own work, has no need to have other people controlling them, to provide them with apparatus. Somebody who works with others, but will never work for anybody ever again.
And I completely agree with you. I don't disagree with anything you said. I'm just apparently having trouble putting forth some of my points.
And that's the same problem I'm having, because I'm not arguing. No, I'm not saying domineer, control, you know, dominate anybody. I'm just simply stating, yes, the elites have great power. Yes, they are capable of fielding great armies and doing great feats with their mystical, you know,
whatever
powering pieces of technology, you know. What I'm saying is it's a total dichotomy to be locked in the state of fear of, oh my God, they're so almighty powerful. Look at the New World Order. They did this, this, and this over here. So we just can't do anything to stop them because they did that, that, and that. See, that's just it's total fear.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
It's the master. Yeah,
that's one of their main tactics.
And mm-hmm. It's the main tactic that you can see anywhere else throughout whatever speciality that you're in on the globalists, the New World Order, the banking cartel, the cabal, whatever the heck you want to call them. It's the same thing. They use that same psychologically projected mm-hmm. fear. I know how this stuff works. Mm-hmm. I have family members who use these same yep. type of tactics.
And if the individual is scared, stupid, then they're too much in a fear base to have their little one-man operation to do their thing, to make their difference. If they're sitting there in the corner, terrified, going, "There's nothing I can do." That's all I was saying.
I understand that, and I agree. You know, fear is often a paralytic agent. It injects a biological reaction in you to either render you inert or make you run away. Right?
Yeah, that is all the fuck I was trying to say, and you took it in a different direction than what I was trying to say.
I'm aggro today, and we're talking about Santilli, and it makes me like crazy, and That's the other thing. If you're dealing with the past, they make you crazy, you know.
Yeah, you did what I'm guilty of sometimes. So I'm not trying to be the pot calling the kettle black.
Okay, can I? Some people think that a life free from fear and trauma is a good thing, right? But I actually disagree, because when I was 20, I got arrested for selling cannabis, right? And my entire circle of friends disappeared. My relationship with my missus at the time, gone. All my career aspects, gone. All my education aspects, my ability to travel to other country, that got taken from me over 10 years ago, and I had to start my life again. And now I have panic attacks occasionally. I'm terrified of any authority figure that has power over me. I can't even make outbound business phone calls. I can't work for anyone in an employment situation either. If I start getting a regular paycheck from somebody, I start to freak out and don't want to do the work that I'm getting that paycheck for. I can't do it. And I had to make my own career on YouTube and talk radio, just to try and make sure that the way the world truly works actually becomes known.
Yeah.
Now, everybody else can keep their perceptions if they want about fear and trauma, but my guess is that they've got no fucking clue what real suffering is like. They can easily sit around talking about fear and trauma as if they have any idea what they're talking about, but to my mind, trauma is a teacher. Fear is a motivator. And your life itself is the prize in which those things make you get, right? I believe that people need to value their traumas, embrace their fears, and love their life, because everything else is cerebral dribble that will vanish as soon as your happy existence is destroyed by an evil, lying psychopath with no conscience, all right? And that'll put somewhat of a damper in any chipper disposition, won't it?
I completely agree. As a matter of fact, cycling in the illusion of happiness is just as paralytic as cycling in nonstop, unending fear and trauma. Yeah, fear and trauma can be a teacher, I agree. And at the same time, nothing wrong with being happy either. There needs to be
you've just come up with a great realization here, bro. It's not the fear. It's the disempowerment. You can be afraid, but you can also be brave because you know you can do something about it, right? But if you're disempowered, right, it's like the greatest trick a dictator ever pulled was convincing people that they don't have the power to stop them.
Yeah, exactly. I talk about what you just said quite frequently, and I refer to it as the emotional negative feedback loop that people get caught in. I always tell people, if you want to not be angry and not be scared, then let yourself be angry and let yourself be scared. Because if you don't, then you start becoming angry about being angry, about being angry, about being angry, scared about being scared, about being scared, about being scared, etc. It is the emotional equivalent of speaking into the microphone. It comes out the speakers, goes back into the microphone, and there's a building oscillation, and that's what causes the paralysis. That is what I suggest people avoid.
That being said, I was going to make a finer point about Joseph Stalin. One of the greatest illusions that he pulled in the early days of the Soviet Union is he would just randomly pick, you know, send his police, his secret police or whatever, out into the streets, randomly pick people and shoot them for no reason. And then, you know, a few days later, you know, there'd be all of this mass propaganda out there that, you know, the people that they shot were somehow traitors somehow. And it didn't make any sense, but it was a fear-based psychological tactic. It was basically, oh, they're too big to stop. You know, they're too dangerous. They're too heavily armed. They're too powerful. There are too many of them. It was, you know, the fact is, it's like what the Nazis did in Nazi Germany. They were just a bunch of, they started out as nothing more than a tiny group of little whiny little radicals, you know, that spewed nothing but vomit and nonsense. And the way they took control was, you know, to appear that they had greater numbers and that they were more powerful than they really were. You know,
and you just perfectly described the current operating procedure of the mainstream media.
Exactly. And the globalists and everybody else, they use the power of illusion. You know, and let's just be
realistic. Can I make a point here? Because you've made a really great observation there. Because in my opinion, the New World Order has actually been quite successful at brainwashing people into believing there's no such thing as a New World Order. And mm-hmm. a lot of the other people think that it's all powerful, can't be resisted. But I think people give it far too much credit, because if controlling the world was your goal, chief among your objectives would be to confuse people so that they don't know what they're dealing with, mm-hmm. and secondly, implant a feeling of helplessness that whatever's being done can't be stopped. Mm-hmm. Personally, I don't hold to that philosophy. I prefer the endless war model for my life. There's 6 points to it. Number one, I'm going to die anyway, so I'd rather die fighting. Number two, I probably can't win, but I have a moral obligation to resist. Number three, I'm terrified of what might happen to me, but I'm even more frightened of doing nothing. Number four, just because we're being exterminated, that doesn't mean we can't make it fun. Otherwise, uh-huh. what's the point of being killed? Number five, don't worry, it's just the end of the world. And number six, don't stress, man. Things are a lot worse than you think they are.
Hey, Vinny, one thing that I've noticed, especially here in the States, especially lately in the last year, there's been a lot more people starting to wake up about things. You know, the people who the year before would have just, like, pointed at us and called us conspiracy theorists, and now they're like, oh my god, this shit's for real.
What's happening in this country and all over the planet is people are beginning to learn why fire is hot and fire is dangerous. And another thing, I want to go on to my other point here. This is going to be a rant, so just be ready, because this is going to take me a while.
Well, I was trying to ask Vinny a question, though. I was leading to a question. If I can ask Vinny a question. My question is, with all this accelerated awakening that the elites did not see coming, could not plan for, because they're arrogant and they're fucking narcissists, and they think that they're all powerful and their plans could never possibly have any kinks, do you think that any of them are getting, a little desperate and scared themselves because they see people waking up and going, fuck, that wasn't supposed to happen? What's your take on that?
Okay, first of all, they've anticipated uprisings, they've anticipated awakenings, they've anticipated a whole bunch of stuff. Why do you think a lot of the truth movement doesn't actually encourage people to take action? People just sit there vicariously watching it like sports fans watching a game being played in front of them and then taking credit when they're on the winning team, okay? The best way to stop an uprising is to lead it yourself. Lenin said that, and I believe that a lot of the leaders in the truth movement are indeed working for the other side in order to direct them very cleverly, very stealthily, in the wrong direction, away from self-empowerment, away from individuality, into collectivism and the idea of the us versus them. You know, I used to call people who weren't awake slaves and slave scum and stuff like that, or sheeple, and now I don't call them that anymore, because I realize they're simply mind control victims, just like I was, just like I still am. Okay, mm-hmm. A lot of people don't realize that they're under mind control. I can give you a pretty easy methodology. How do you know if you're under mind control? If you've never questioned whether or not you're under mind control. All right, so here's, I really want to let you have your rant, bro, but last up on this, are the elite afraid? Yeah, they are afraid. They're psychopaths, so they have an overactive reptilian brain which governs fight or flight. That means when you get threatened, you've got some frontal lobe activity, you've got some emotions and things like that, and it stops the signal from getting through to a degree. You don't suddenly freak out into direct fight or flight mode. They don't have any of that back channel. That's why they are reactionary. They just go, I'm going to kill you, you know, all of a sudden incredibly aggressive, or they become really afraid. They found that they did a study, an analysis I've been told about psychopaths on the battlefield. You know, you'd figure if somebody was a killer and they had no conscience and stuff like that, they'd be great in wars, right? wrong. Whenever the shit gets deep, they're fucking cowards, and they run for it, all right? And as soon as a bully realizes that they're not going to have a victim that won't resist them, they become really frightened really quickly. And the problem is, though, once they get frightened, that's when they start to get really dangerous, yeah. So it's six in one hand, half dozen in the other.
Yeah, that's why I've heard a lot of people say that, you know, even if right now there are enough people waking up in just the right way, that we are actually winning against the elites. Winning against them is when they're going to be their most dangerous.
I also don't like this term waking up, you know, because it means that, oh, I'm awakened, you know? It's just okay. Like, dude,
starting to realize, starting to come into awareness of whatever the fuck you want to say, going from not knowing anything to, oh fuck, that light is the
No. It's not about labels. No, it's not about labels. It's about the process. Anybody can wake up, but do they get out of bed? Do they go to work? Okay? Do they have breakfast? Do they have their coffee? You know, that kind of thing. People don't follow these things through to their logical conclusions. Being awakened and knowing what is going on is not good enough.
Well, then, let me rephrase. If there's enough people who are awakened in the practical application stages of acting on what they know...
No. The word is not awakened. It is activated. Okay? That's when you become an activist. Okay? That's... Activists... I know so many activists, and it's unbelievable.
Okay, dude.
They are so badly traumatized, yet they work their asses off every single day to fuck with psychopaths, all right? These are the people that have protected humanity since the dawn of time, okay? You think about this as a battle between angels and demons where, let's say, we have human beings.
Universe, I get it. You're giving me a taste of my own medicine through Vinny Eastwood. I repent of my sins here. My point was just simply that, you know, even if we are in the part, whatever semantical terminology you want to use, activated, blah, 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 whatever, to where by whatever reason, we are actually winning against the elites. Winning against them is when they are going to be the most dangerous, because they are the rabid dog trapped in the corner, and they will do anything.
I don't see any evidence of any kind that we're winning. The Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, it's going to be signed in early February. All of our data sets, all our technology, social media is already being surveilled on giant data banks. We're all going on lists. Mainstream media just seems to be getting bigger and better the whole time. The world seems to be getting more toxic.
Yet again. Thank you.
Yeah.
Big thing on that, technology, more fear porn. Okay, let's be realistic on this here. Okay, yeah, they're monitoring everything we do on the internet worldwide all the time. Yeah, they've been doing that for years. They've been wiretapping phones. They've been doing every form of surveillance known to mankind for about the last 40, 50 years. Yeah, no, they've been doing it for a long time. Yet again, is it fear porn? Absolutely. Here's why. Okay, let's be realistic about this. Sure, they might be monitoring us with computers and, you know, just electronically monitoring. There's nobody on the other end listening live. The only people who are going to be listening live are to high important targets who are, you know, real threats to the globalists. They want to make us think that they've got, you know, a bunch of hitmen that are all out to come get us. See, the thing is, what they rely so much on for control is average individuals like us. And I can tell you right now, that's a double-edged sword, because number one, there aren't, you know, 300 million police officers in the United States that are going to go hunt down 300 million civilians, throw them into FEMA camps, and gas them or do whatever the hell it is that they plan on doing. You know, so they, yet again, want to make themselves seem bigger than they really are. It's like the guy in the shadow standing there looking bigger than he really is, when in fact he might just be a pipsqueak standing next to a flashlight. You know, are they dangerous? Yeah. Are they like a rabid dog? Absolutely. But I don't see them just, you know, coming down, kicking everybody's door down, killing everybody because they said poo-poo about the globalists on the internet. I just don't see it happening because simply they don't have the manpower, they don't have the resources to do it. Are they multi-trillionaires? Yeah. Do they have large pieces of technology that are pretty incredible? Yeah. But there's only a real extent of what they can do. And what it would really come down to, if they really became really dangerous, the only way they'd effectively be able to get rid of 7 billion people is if they decided to just launch every nuclear and biological weapon on the face of the planet.
And they happen to have giant underground cities that they can escape to when they want to.
You mean, a pretty-looking tomb is still a tomb.
And the reason they won't do that is because what kind of victory is it when you can't even control the planet?
Well, I think the reason why they don't do that is because they don't want to be locked underground in the dark with the world's worst pedophiles and psychopathic criminals.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
A pretty tomb is still a tomb, as Dave just said. Yeah. No, they're not going to blow themselves off the face of the map.
However, we're dealing with insane suicidal nihilists. So.
It doesn't even really matter that we're dealing with insane suicidal nihilists. It doesn't really matter. How many times in the last hundred years have they come close to the point of wiping this planet completely clean? I mean, in the Cuban Missile Crisis, you're telling me there weren't nutcases sitting there ready to press the red button and say, let's launch every nuclear missile in the United States arsenal, and there weren't paid globalist guys sitting on the other side in the Soviet Union wanting to do the same thing? Of course there were. We've come so close to nuclear Armageddon so many times it's not even funny, and it hasn't happened yet. Because at the end of the day, even those insane psychos, those insane nut jobs at the very top, know that if they try to blow up the entire planet, what the hell are they going to have left to rule over? They're going to be fighting each other for whatever's left, and that's not going to
be anything. Okay, so if that's the case, why are they chemtrailing everything, poisoning the entire food supply, all the water supplies, all the air, all the land, and everything like that with toxic shit that's being sprayed into everything? They're already destroying the planet, and they don't need nukes to do it.
Because they think that that level of it is something they can undo. I mean,
I think it's because they hold the nukes over us like a fear porn magic button, just saying, oh, don't resist the elite, they'll nuke us all, but then they'll nuke themselves, oh, but they've got underground bases, blah, 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 and it just, again, creates that confusion and that fear and that lack of thought, okay?
I'm not thinking of lack of thought here, and I'm not getting trapped. I'm going to a very good conclusion here. I'm not arguing with you. Yes, they are poisoning the planet, but as Dave just said, it's because they think they can reverse the damage. You know, yet again, these people are psychopaths, and the way they think is down to the very, very, very fine microscopic hair. They think they're gods, and they think they can just play everything like a chessboard. You know, they think they can clear-cut forests and there's not going to be any consequences. They think that they can, you know, poison all the water with arsenic and nasty chemicals. They think they can chemtrail the skies, that they can put GMOs in our crops, that they can, you know, kill us and inject us with all of these nasty, you know, mercury-filled.
I think you're making the classic mistake. I think you're making the classic mistake of applying logic to insane people.
No, I don't think so. Do insane people think they're God? Are they arrogant? Do they think they know it all? Do they have delusions of grandeur? Do they think they can fix everything?
Do sane people understand insane people's thoughts? No, they don't. Because in order to understand, you'd have to be crazy. That's why it seems so out of place. That's why when actions and lies and things like that come out of psychopath's mouth, everybody goes, why would he say that? And people make that classic mistake, you know? It's just like, oh,
Here's a question, though. Name a psychopath that hasn't also been a narcissist.
There aren't any, because every psychopath is also a narcissist. But I can also name you plenty of narcissists who aren't psychopaths. You know what causes narcissism? Not being loved enough when you're a child. it. Mm-hmm. And narcissism was named after the Greek fable of Narcissus, who loved himself so much and loved his reflection that he bent into a river to kiss his reflection and drowned himself. The reason why people came up with narcissism and all of that kind of stuff is because the brain is reacting to protect itself and to love itself because it is not getting enough external love and stimuli. However, mm-hmm. if you take that, you don't get any love, and you get abused, then you get tipped over the scale. You become a psychopath, right? Mm-hmm. Or at least that's how I've seen it work. Because I know that I'm a narcissist. Mm-hmm. I had a look at the personality profiles. I'm 100% narcissistic. But question. I have a morality. I have a conscience. I have love for other people. I don't question. Lie. I'm pathologically honest. Everything.
Question.
Before you ask me this question, I want to just compare myself to a psychopath. Everything that is good about me, you know, it's my charm, my intellect, and so on and so forth. Psychopaths also have those traits, but I don't have the bad traits that come with it, right? That's why I hate psychopaths so much, because they remind me so much of myself. And sometimes when things are so dark, you simply need another kind of bad guy to go in to fight for you. And that's what I consider myself, the good bad guy in this situation, in the war against psychopaths.
Question. Do psychopathic narcissists think they are always right and everyone else is always wrong?
They can actually pass lie detector tests because they believe their own lies.
Exactly. So, to the best of my research, these elites think they're gods and they could do anything, you know, the whole transhumanism thing. So the reason they are chemtrailing and doing all this destruction is because they either think that A, they can undo it, or B, they can live through it, through their transhumanism.
The reason why.
They're delusional. So if they thought that all this was going to kill them too, they wouldn't do it. But they are delusional enough to think that they can control it and keep themselves safe. And because they're psychopathic narcissists, they believe their own bullshit.
Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing. I mean, you know, just as you said, Dave, there is a logic to it from their perspective and their perspective only, because they believe their crap so much that they think whatever they can do, they can somehow circumvent or overcome because they are God. They are the Almighty. They control mm-hmm. everything. They control the geopolitical state of their nation or the planet or whatever. They think they can just buy themselves out of trouble, you know.
And that's how you fuck them, in the blind spot of their
exactly.
arrogance. Because you know what? If they listen to this, let's say hypothetically they were listening to this conversation right now and hearing me saying, you know, we can win against them through the blind spot of their arrogance because they're delusional and they think they know they think they're always right and they're not right all the time, they'd laugh at me and go, oh, silly peasant, he doesn't know I am right all the time. Oh, I can fix everything. I can do this. They wouldn't take this conversation seriously or as a threat. They think it's laughable.
Yeah, they'd think it was just a giant piece of humor. They'd be laughing at every word coming out of our mouths, saying that we're stupid, naive, and we're dumb, when in reality, we're just looking at a bunch of nutcases with a whole lot of money and just going, yeah, here's the logic of it, and this is why they do everything that they do. You know,
they're psychopaths.
I've noticed that same phenomenon is that they simply sit there and they have no creativity. So the only thing that they can do is invert things. So let's say the truth is they control the world. They come out and the only thing that they can say is we don't control the world, because they simply can tell you the exact opposite of the truth. Now, if you want to have a really good laugh, a really fucking good laugh, watch an Obama speech, you know, like a State of the Nation address or something like that.
Oh my God,
there was this one time I was hurting, gut laughing so much, and just the complete opposite of the truth, every single sentence. Giving him an ovation.
Jobs.
Obamacare creates jobs.
You want another good laugh? You want another good laugh? Here's what they actually don't know, and unfortunately most of the world doesn't know this either, but hopefully they'll catch on quick. What we've seen, I've seen it, Rich have seen it, many other people have seen it. The police and the military here are starting to activate. I mean, if you would have talked to me 6 months ago, I'd have thought hell would have frozen over first, but they actually are. And we see it more and more and more. Most people don't know what's happening.
I showed you those lies, like how the psychopaths do. They just tell you the direct opposite. But human beings are different. They've got creativity. They've got inspiration. They have the ability to create things, see things, rather, inside their own head that do not exist, have never existed on the planet before. And they're capable of willing and building those things and creating them in the 3D universe. Okay, that is the strength we have that psychopaths don't have. That's why the psychopaths are also jealous of man, right?
Exactly.
They need us. They need us to survive. They need to torture us in order to suck our fear energy, and they need our ideas so that they can steal them, all right? Mm-hmm. That's the only reason why they need us around. Just like a farmer needs cattle, psychopaths need human beings.
Agreed. Mm-hmm. Completely agreed. But I'm just saying, I don't know. I'm not sure if you knew that the police and the military here are actually starting to activate. And I'll tell you why they're starting to activate. Same reason a lot of people here in the United States, more than most people think, are starting to activate. Us Americans have a particular type of stubbornness. Basically, until we are getting our heads beaten into the wall on a very personal level, we're going to look at something and we're going to either say, that's not really happening, or, yeah, that's happening, but that's over there, and that's not my problem.
Okay, can I... there was a study recently that proves your point. Exactly. It was a study of asking Americans how intelligent they think they are in regards to the average person. Only 4% of Americans think that they're dumber than the average person.
Yeah.
Which statistically, at least 50% of them are, right? So it comes down to being dumb, and so dumb that we don't know how dumb we are. And the same goes for almost every country, because the ability to be intelligent and actually being intelligent in and of itself gets demonized
things.
And it's not valued at all. If you're intelligent, did you know that you can't get a job as a comm? If you're too
smart?
I know.
I know that. The excuse they use here is that someone too smart would get bored with police work, but the real reason is someone too smart would question authority when given an illegal order.
And realize that they're working for a criminal organization and not mindlessly obey authority.
It's like an interview I heard years ago. I can't remember quite what documentary I heard it in. It might have been one of the InfoWars documentaries, or it was a documentary I heard, you know, a long time ago, but they'd interviewed a bunch of Marines who were stationed in a barracks over in the Middle East, and they were handing out surveys and stuff. And these were all guys, I think, that were about to go home, and they were sending out redeployment surveys or something. And they literally had a question in the survey that said, if the order were given by your commanding officer, would you fire upon your own civilians? Would you fire upon Americans to confiscate firearms if such an order were given? And the Marines that said no were automatically honorably discharged, and the Marines who said, you know, no comment, or, you know, checked the unfathomable yes box, were still left in the military. So,
now,
I mean,
Kelso, I've got to go very, very shortly. Sorry, bro, for interrupting. No. Finish your point, please.
Oh no, I was just about to say, you know, that, I mean, that just goes to show, you know, it's really stupid how, you know, dumb they think some people are that they would answer that question. But I mean, it is kind of a legit question, and it just kind of shows their pathology a little bit, and, you know.
And I wanna say one last thing if I can, because I know Vinny's gotta go like ungodly soon. I wanted to say that, you know, because of what I was saying before about, you know, Americans don't start to activate until it's deep and personal, and they're getting their heads, you know, slammed into the wall and fucked over in some way, shape, or form. the more the police state starts to tighten their grip, you know, like Princess Leia said, the more you tighten your grip, the more star systems will slip through your fingers. Well, that effect is starting to happen here, and people are activating it in droves because now the people are getting fucked with on a personal level, and they can't say, that's not really happening, or that has nothing to do with me, because the shit is coming home to roost. That's why in a lot of ways I am thankful for all the crap that's going down here, because people are activating in fucking droves on levels I would have never thought were even possible a year ago. And the funny, amusing thing is that the elites don't see it, because it's within the blind spot of their arrogance, because, you know, like we were saying, they could listen to us talk to this and they'd go, ha ha, silly peasants, they don't know anything, ha ha. But we've been getting so fucked here that people are activating left and right because things have been getting tighter and tighter and tighter. So going back to the Star Wars quote, and I think that's great. I look at it this way. If the elites want to help us wake up inadvertently, and if the American public feels that they need that kick to the head in order to activate, so be it. You know, who am I to judge? If that's what each American feels they need, I don't have the right to tell them how, you know, they should live their lives. Yet, otherwise, I'm as bad as the elites.
Yet again, it's like I said earlier, it's, you know, if it takes physical action from the elite to, you know, make people understand why fire is hot on some level and go, wait a minute, this is really dangerous. We need to put an end to this, you know, so be it. You know, if that's what it takes, that's what it takes.
It's that last part that's important, not the, oh, poor little me, I'll just stand here and spectate, but being mad enough and fucked over enough that you're going to stand up and be like, you know, not only do I want to understand what's going on, I want to put a stop to that. I want to learn how to put a stop to that. And there's so many people in that boat here now. And if you had asked me 6 months ago whether or not I thought that was going to be possible this soon, I'd have laughed and said, no way, humans are dumb.
Right. So I'll just say one last thing then. To awaken people requires the seventh man methodology. Now, if one person comes to you and says 9/11 is an inside job and it's totally outside your paradigm, you tell them, fuck off, you're a conspiracy theorist. Second person, same thing. All the way up to the seventh man. Statistically speaking, if seven different people come up to you and tell you the exact same thing, even if it's contrary to your current beliefs, your beliefs will then start to change. Now, what that means is don't try to convince people of the truth. Simply tell them one true thing, and they walk away like an information grenade. That's what
exactly.
It takes to wake. That's what it takes to wake people up. But
exactly.
Activating people, you can't activate people. Only psychopaths can do that. Only people who have been traumatized or have seen their loved ones be destroyed and things like that. You basically have to be so badly threatened and traumatized and destroyed as a person before you will consider not just abandoning your beliefs, but abandoning your entire life up to that point and change everything about who you are and what you do. And your family won't recognize you, you'll lose most of your friends, and you will become a completely different person. That's what it means to be an activist, to
yep.
be the one who is protecting everybody else and to be hated for it, but knowing that it is the right thing to do and making that sacrifice willingly because you are the only one with the choice to do it. Now,
exactly.
you'll always get abused. You know, people, like somebody said to me on Facebook the other day, something along the line was that, talking with you feels like I'm speaking with a paranoid conspiracy theorist who smokes too much weed. And I was like, well, that's funny, because talking to you feels like I'm speaking with an arrogant, educated idiot that believes everything they hear, except if it conflicts with their current programmed subset of beliefs. Right.
Exactly. Exactly.
<I'm> sorry.
On another topic, Dave would know how this relates. I don't know if you would, but have you watched or seen Star Wars Episode 7?
Yeah.
I love the opening scene, and it's been long enough.
Spoiler
now.
Alert.
Yep, spoiler alert. It's been
spoiler
long
alert.
Enough now. Anybody who hasn't seen it, you're going to have to go see it. But I love the beginning scene where, you know, Finn is standing there in that clone trooper outfit. You know, it kind of reminds me of the current state of humanity right now. You know, he's looking back and forth. He's seeing the choice. He has a choice in front of him. You know, here's all these other guys slaughtering this entire village, and here he is. He made that. You can literally see without seeing his face. He's making that conscious choice that he's not going to follow it anymore. And that's the state we're in right now. You know, people are starting to realize what's happening, and it's like, you know, do I really want to be a part of this, or do I want to do something about it? You know, sure, we're all one person, we're all the individual, but as individuals, you know, who have different talents, different abilities, and different, you know, capabilities, if we come together mutually, and that's out of, and not everybody's going to do that, but, you know, people who do come together can make a difference, you know. I mean, just the four of us sitting here on this PSEC hangout, you know, that's that's an example of that. You know, we're speaking our minds, we're getting it out there, we're putting it across social media, and, you know, hopefully there will be people that will eventually watch this in the future that will be inspired to do something of their own accord, you know, and that's the goal. But really what it comes down to is that personal initiative, that personal choice to say, no, I'm not going to be a part of this anymore. You know, I want to change things for the better.
I always tell people, no human is capable of convincing another human of anything by force. Then people say, well, then why are you out here, you know, saying what you're saying and doing what you're doing? And I'm like, well, that's simple. It's so that other like-minded people can know that they're not alone, and because they can't read my mind, in order for them to know I'm here, I need to speak. Unfortunately, speaking also means that the not-so-like-minded are also going to hear me.
Exactly. When you put your flag up in the long grass because you're a pygmy and you can't see the other pygmies around you and you're lost, not only can your allies see you and start coming towards you to bring you back to the tribe, but the lion that is in the grass can see you as well. And it's only a question of which one of them will reach you first. But you have to put your flag up, and you have to face the lion sooner or later, because you don't know that you are lost.
Yep. Bingo.
All right, guys. Well, thank you very much for coming on the show. Kelso, this is actually the best show. This is the best show we've ever done, bro. Really great discussion here, man. And I'm sorry I was a bit of a dick earlier. Yeah.
Oh, don't worry about it.
No, I do worry about it, because I'm a narcissist, and if I don't remain vigilant and apologize for the when I'm behaving badly, it automatically self-reinforces and I get worse and worse.
Let me rephrase then. From my perspective, and I'm of course allowed to have my own point of view on things, I don't think you did anything wrong. I think you were just being honest and being yourself and allowing yourself your mood, and I think that's an important thing for humans to do, because we live in a society that says, no, stuff your feelings, hide your thoughts, don't be you, don't be authentic, appease everybody, kiss ass and blindly follow orders and blah, blah, blah. So,
not exactly something I have any affinity for, but...
yeah, so, you know, never, as I do believe it was Gandhi who said it, or maybe it was somebody else, but never apologize for being yourself. So from my perspective, you were just being you, so therefore you did nothing wrong. I did not take anything you did or said as rude or inappropriate or blah, blah, what the fuck ever. If you want to feel sorrowful, I respect your right as a malignant narcissist to do that, but I'm
not... Benign narcissist is the nasty kind.
Okay.
They're like lying, fucking filthy scumbags, and I hate fucking malignant narcissists as well.
Benign narcissist, then. Whatever, you know, pink and purple. Purple narcissist, whatever you dress up.
No. There's actually a definition, bro. There's actually a definition. This isn't me just making shit up. All right.
I know.
A benign narcissist is somebody like Muhammad Ali. All right. Somebody who's really, really self-confident and fucking talented and brilliant and charming, but they didn't get as much love as the children, and that's the reason why they became so advanced in what they do, because they weren't able to get that stimuli from outside, and they needed to find it within themselves.
Okay. Well, either way, you can view it however you want, whatever makes you feel better. I'm just saying.
I view it via the definition with facts, you know.
Okay.
Sorry.
Well, my point is that you can feel sorrowful if you want and think you did something wrong if you like. I'm not obligated to agree with you.
Oh, no,
I think
that's not
you,
what
I
I'm doing. I'm talking about recognizing. I'm just talking about recognizing it, because even if other people aren't offended by it, even if they don't notice it, I notice it, and I'm offended by it. And I endeavor to improve myself on a daily basis. I don't apologize for being me, but I do promise to be a better me than I was yesterday.
Well, like I've said to you more than once, you're worse than a chick when it comes to taking a fucking compliment.
I'm terrible at taking compliments. Absolutely terrible. In fact, dude, it's funny you should mention that.
But you're great yesterday, at taking a dick insider.
And yesterday, somebody paid me a compliment on my YouTube channel because of that Santilli video, right? Mm-hmm. And I compliments don't come through for me. They very, very rarely. And it felt strange to me because this guy, he just thanked me in such a way that for maybe the first time in a long time, that compliment actually came through and I actually felt it, you know? Like, maybe I'm changing for the better. Maybe some of the bad things about me are being gotten rid of. I don't know exactly what's happening.
I think so. I think they are, from my observations. Not that I fucking know everything, but from my observations, you're improving. I've noticed improvement in you.
Yeah, I'm trying to eliminate that. It's like, I don't know, when you get raised not very well and it's in a violent situation where you don't have much love and you're like a terror and you're really violent and you're a bully and that kind of thing. All of these things I am. Not was, am. I'm still all those things. However, I'm managing to get better control over them on a daily basis, and I think that's just part of being human. None of us are perfect, but the time that we stop being human is when we choose to stop embittering ourselves. Here it is. I found it. Archimedian I, I think was his YouTube channel. I have already downloaded this video, and if that cocksucker even tries to have this video removed, he's going to open up a world of duplicates across YouTube and other platforms. Great edit, Vinny. And I said, I normally can't take a compliment, but for whatever reason, your one really got through to me tonight. Cheers, bro. Big hugs.
Well, if my compliments don't get through to you and you require me beating you over the head with an aluminum bat in order for the compliment to register in your brain, just let me know and I'll bring the bat.
Here's the Mexican word of the day, Lysol. I don't trust Obama because he Lysol'd the time.
All right, guys. Have a nice night, eh?
Hey, it's just like I said the other day. I commune with aliens, but don't worry, they're all here legally.
Cheers, guys.
Have a good day. And for everybody else watching out there, you can check out Vinny on his YouTube channel. Just do a Google search for Vinny Eastwood or Vinny Eastwood Show. It'll come up, like, right there. And if you don't see it, you're fucking legally blind.
Yeah, it's Vinny with a Y, because it's the most important question. And Eastwood, like, go ahead, make my news.
Yeah, either blind or fluoridated into, you know, but either way.
Mm-hmm. Cheers, guys. Catch you later.
Have a good one, Vinny. Catch you later, bro.
Bye-bye.
Later. Yeah.
Just doing the little Common Core thing there.
Yeah, I know. Mm-hmm. I know.
But anyway,
I never thought it. I'm a Common Core student. Mm.
Yeah, no kidding. Another point I wanted to make, but, you know, we all got on really good sidetrack conversation there. Back to the Stalin thing in the Soviet Union. See, the reason why Stalin was so successful in his takeover, in his brutal occupation and takeover, is because when push came to shove and the Bolsheviks started going for people's firearms, nobody resisted. Nobody fought back. Stalin had been so brilliant with his his deployment of mass propaganda and mass fear porn, that people were so afraid, people were so scared that they allowed that to compromise their clarity, compromise their critical thinking, and compromise any drive or motivation to fight back. And when, you know, the limited number of officers that they had came, nobody resisted. So mass confiscation was a success, and, you know, the hope for any free Russia just disappeared for the next, like, you know, 70 years or whatever. And, you know, then 20 or 30 million people slaughtered later, you know, you go into the Khrushchev era and all the way on up into, you know, Yeltsin and, you know, all of that stuff. But the main thing is that the globalists invest in is that psychological, you know, whether it be a dictator of a country or, you know, the globalists up at the very top, it's the same thing. They invest in that psychological, you know, projection of, you know, instilling fear in people and saying, oh, well, because they have all this technology, all these armies, all of these machines, all of the, you know, all of these weapons of mass destruction, whatever you want to call it, that we're powerless to stop them, when in reality, it's quite the opposite. You know, we are more than capable of stopping them, because without us, they would have never gotten any of those things to begin with, because it took us, the individuals, us at the bottom, us, the pawns, to build all of those things, to create all of those things, to design all of those things, you know, because the elites are not rocket scientists. They are not engineers. They are not aviators. They are not janitors. They are not soldiers. They are not desk clerks. They are not chefs. They are not courier drivers. They are not, you know, maids. They are not lawn people. They are not, you know, paper boys going down the street throwing papers at people's doors. They are not any of those things. They are the narcissists at the top that hijacked their way to the top, killed the most people that they had to get to the top, and now sit on a pile of money and use fear and, you know,
money that they create out of thin air
and then debt at
interest.
And then they take the real hard asset, the real asset, gold and silver, and then they make more fake money on top of that that they use. They don't even use their own real asset. What they use is created asset. They get so high up that they control and create all of the monetary systems that everybody else uses. That's why you no longer see gold or silver or any rare metal in currency of any kind in the United States or anywhere around the world, for that matter. Because any country that decided to go on the fiduciary system would be invaded tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow. So are the Chinese and are the Russians building up? I mean, yeah, there are a bunch of countries building on their gold reserves and stuff. You know, that's one thing. But do you ever see a country make the bold move of, you know, making their currency out of any hard asset? No, because the moment they do that, that's declaring monetary war. And why is everybody going
to war? BRICS, which Russia's a part of, actually is declaring monetary war. They're outside of the fiat
system. Well, yes, that is true. They are declaring monetary war, but the main reason they haven't been invaded is because Russia is number two in the world for nuclear weapons. They are number two in the world for Air Force. They are number two in the world for Army. Yep. They are number two in the world for just about everything next to the United States.
And China's right there with them, and their allies.
China's number three.
Although, admittedly, China kind of plays both sides against the middle, because China's, mm-hmm, like, really fucked right now. China plays both sides.
Yeah, the Communist Party sold China to the Rothschilds, but at the same time, the people of China are more towards the freedom and, you know, going towards, you know, a new world, a better world. So yeah, China's kind of in a state of what you would call monetary civil war.
Yeah.
Put it that way. China's, you know, kind of the... China is what I would call, in geopolitical terms, the buffer zone. It's where East and West clash. It's the buffer zone.
You know, when Vinny was talking about narcissism and all that, I mean, I really didn't notice whether or not Vinny seemed to flip a switch, and he certainly wasn't acting like any kind of crazy pants or a flake or anything.
I think he was just being passionate. He was just talking about what was important to him. I don't see how that's narcissistic at all. I mean, you know, I'm glad if he, I'm not going to say what he does or doesn't have, but I'm, you know, I'm glad that he's forward, honest, you know, he's got integrity. He's got integrity 100% and he's willing to call his weaknesses, which is something that I'm working to do, which I know is something that you do, you know. Yeah. It's something that we all strive to work at, you know, and calling out your weaknesses and saying, hey, this is the reality of the situation, like it or hate it, you know, and I just apologize if what I did came off as, you know, this or that or the other thing. See, that's a very noble thing. I don't think there's anything wrong with that whatsoever.
When you, when you call out your weaknesses, then you can use them as strength.
Exactly. Exactly. But, you know. Yeah, I think this has been a really good conversation. This has probably been one of the best conversations I've had in a long time.
It has. It totally has.
Trent, this is kind of made up for the last year.
Trent and Kristen would have loved it. Katarina would have hated it. I think it got way too thick into the political stuff her case.
Katarina probably would have left midway through.
Yeah. And Daphne, I'm not really sure what her position on it would have been. Like, she's not opposed to political conversation, but I don't think it's really like her main cup of tea.
I'm not sure what her tolerance is on it. I think the military stuff, because I know she's into the military type stuff. I think the military stuff would have gotten her interest, because I know we've had some really good conversations on, you know, aircraft and, you know. She seems to be pretty much in the...
Excuse me for all the yawning and mouth covering and eye moving and everything else. In the last, like, for most of the day, I've only gotten, like, 2 hours of sleep. So I'm... sorry about that.
Yeah, but, I mean, she's into the military stuff, but not... She's not, I don't know what her stance on geopolitics is. I know Katarina would have probably left like in the first 5 minutes and said, this just isn't happening for me.
Well, not five, maybe 20, 30, something like that. I mean, she's got her preferences. And she's got different, you know, different focuses on things. So it's like, you know, I don't really, you know, blame her for that. And she also likes for the topics to be mixed up and varied. She likes to spice it up and have a variety. And, you know, when anybody gets like way too focused, like too far in on politics and stuff, she just loses interest real fast. So.
Well, yeah, some people either get it and they understand it and they know it and I know it.
Oh, she gets it. She just didn't like it.
Well, I mean, yeah, what I'm trying to say is, I mean, you either really get it, you understand it, and you like the political science, or you either get it and you just don't really give a shit because it's boring to you and your personal taste, or you don't get it at all. You're so lost that you don't even know where you stand and you're like, what the fuck are you talking about? You sound like you're talking about, you know, random nonsense. Because I've known people of all different persuasions, you know. There's general consensuses, but it's not really anything that's like entirely defined. It's generally based on the person.
Yeah. Speaking of all this stuff, I'm really not sure how Trump even has a chance in hell of being president, because, you know, even if he does get all the popular votes, the Electoral College is there to override the vote of the people. So, you know, they're just going to put in who they want anyway, and I highly doubt they want Trump. So, you know, unless he's got a way of overriding the Electoral College. I mean,
it's
great that Trump is making people think and shaking things up. That's cool, but I really don't see how he's got a snowball's chance in hell.
The only way I can ever see him getting in is I mean, I hate that we've come to such a system where you have to pay people off, but, you know, he'd be the kind of guy that'd have to bribe some people. in order for that to happen.
Yeah, pay people to leave the vote alone and leave it as it is, exactly. And to actually have
to a allow fair the actual democratic process to occur.
Yeah,
that's because I've seen every election period, and we're coming up on 2016 here, folks. So, I mean, in November, we're going to be seeing news stories about tampered voting booths and, you know, all of the typical beautiful rainbow colors that come along with voting season, going to the polls to vote for the next president and, you know, other political offices. But, you know, the only way Trump's probably going to make it is if he, you know, sticks to his guns and plays his cards right and does buy people off to keep the vote from being tampered with. Because let's face it, all of these giant multi-trillion dollar corporations, you know, Halliburton, I imagine there's certain parts of the aviation industry like Lockheed Martin, ATK, you know, Boeing, Northrop Grumman, you name it. They're good and bad groups and all of those organizations that are doing all that they can to buy the votes and to buy the politicians.
Yeah. That's what people don't understand about corporations. They're just constructs. Inside every corporation, there's always a civil war. Just like we're seeing a lot of really good awakening, activating, inspiring stuff coming out of Disney like never before, because there's a good aspect inside of Disney that's been rising up and trying to assist for the betterment of humanity. But that dark, nasty, creepy side of Disney, it is still there. It doesn't like that the good side is rising up. And, you know, you can be sure that they're doing everything in their power to try to grab onto the good side and pull it back down again. But every corporation is an internal civil war. That's always. And, like, even, you know, working for a regular corporation, like, entry level, like, you know, if you're answering the phones or whatever, I mean, if you're really paying attention to the to what's around you and paying attention to the internal politics, you will actively see that middle management is split in half and constantly at war with itself, and all the underlings are constantly being used as pawns in, you know, the middle management chess game, all like little children trying to fight for the approval of the higher ups, because they know that if an underling rises to middle and the higher ups like that one, then one of the existing middle management's going to end up getting the boot. So it's all a big fucking nasty game.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, it's all the way to the top. It's a fucked game. But the main thing that I know that I can do and that most people can do, I mean, yeah, we don't have a huge army and, you know, trillions of dollars and, you know, a large air force and a navy to go direct toe-to-toe with the power control freaks. You know, like, there might be some people out there that would like to, but in the very least, what you can do is, you know, talk about it, get it out there, get your thoughts out there, expose it for what it is, you know. And just bring the truth out, you know. That's the main thing that you can do.
Well, as long as I'm just here kind of puffing on my tobacco anyway, and, you know, Vinny's overtime is no longer being infringed because he would have stayed 2 hours, but he only stayed an hour. And as you see, I'm taking off my headphones. He did mention a video that he made in regards to Alex Jones, is he corrupt or not? And, you know, even if he is, why does it matter? I obviously wasn't going to, you know, play that while he was on because obviously, you know, he had limited time. How about I go into screen share mode and, you know, play that now, seeing as, you know, Vinny's gone, so we're not, you know, imposing on his time.
I have a question. Would we also like to play the video on crap? I shared it on DA here. Do we want to play Vinny's video on what's his name? On Pete Santilli? Or do we just want to play the Alex Jones?
I think Vinny's video actually uses a mainstream music track.
Okay. And so in that case, we won't do it. If we don't want to trip the YouTube censors, we won't do it.
Yeah. So, you know.
Okay.
That's kind of what
I'm. While you're pulling up that video and going screen share, I'm going to use that as a commercial break because I need to use the facilities.
All right. And of course, if he happens to use any mainstream track in this one, I will immediately hit stop and hope for the best. But hopefully he.
Well, why not, here's an idea. Before you actually click into it, why don't you put your headphones on and listen to see?
Yeah, that's completely true.
Because that way you can hear it, and if it does, then there's no damage and no risk. So anyway, I will return.
Yeah, I would have thought of that, but I'm fucking tired. So yeah, I will do that right quick. So right now, everybody else out there is just gonna kind of see the video without the audio portion just for a moment, just so I can verify. Okay, everybody, we're safe. We're good. Vinny does have his usual, you know, custom, you know, music intro like he does for all of his stuff, but, you know, that's not any sort of a third-party matching thing. You know, that's always all good for his stuff, just like, you know, I have my PSEC episode, you know, when I have stuff that's pre-recorded, you know, the intro, the, you know, paradigm shift, the educational comedy, it's not a cause, it's not a movement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Vinny's got his own, you know, intro and all that good stuff. Rich, are you back yet? Take that as a no. Let's check the, or, oh, there you are. Oh, I saw the brief little middle finger there. So you are back? Rich. Okay, well, fucking whatever. I'm just gonna wait for Rich right quick. I think maybe he will be back sooner rather than later. Shouldn't take more than a minute or two, and if it takes more, then fuck it, I'll just hit play anyway, and he could stick his middle finger up the fucking, you know, tube of his dick. Oh, and well, I'm waiting. I may as well. Show you the one image that I was referring to earlier. And that is this one. I commune with aliens, but don't worry, they're here legally. Oh, and that also reminds me the video that Vinny was talking about in regards to, you know, Pete Santilli and all that. You can find that on my DeviantArt as well. As you can see here, the unauthorized biography of Pete Santilli. And I got a nice little description here and, you know, a link to the original video and so on and so on and so on. Richard! Maybe he's off looking at porn on his tablet. I don't know. Anyway, without further ado.
I've heard you refer to Alex Jones's broadcast as being one of the focal points for you and in your career, as many of us journalists, for lack of a better word, alternative media journalists out here. Now, I myself, I had an article published by InfoWars. I was a contestant in their last year's reporter contest. Now, having investigated InfoWars since that publication, I've found out that Alex Jones has pretty much omitted facts from his audience regarding 9/11 truth, even cancer cures, providing fear rather than solutions to his audience. And, I mean, seriously, you could do a Google search. I mean, have people forgotten this guy's shameless Y2K broadcast, the fear mongering that happened during that broadcast? And if you haven't, ladies and gentlemen, please Google it, Y2K, Alex Jones, Y2K. Now, he has also deliberately hired a member of the shadow government via Stratfor, that's global intelligence out there in Austin, Texas. And he's got his cronies, his reporters, Dan Bedondi, Darren McBreen, basically covering up the fact that they hired this person. Now, InfoWars has also been caught with their hands in the cookie jar, spreading misinformation recently. There is an article that was published that pretty much caused internet hysteria, stating that the DHS purchased, I believe, 21.6 million rounds of ammo, when in fact the correct amount was 240,000 or so.
Yeah, that was exposed by Occupy Corporatism, our mutual friend Suzanne Posel there. I work for AmericanFreedomRadio.com. Well, I work with AmericanFreedomRadio.com. Danny Romero used to be Alex Jones's producer. And well, as soon as I knew that, you know, I was a big admirer of Alex Jones. But then he started to tell me stories of how he'd driving back to the studio and he'd be listening to Alex Jones on the air going, "Oh my God, I just want the God and everything, and I don't kill my family." And then he pulls up to the studio and Alex has finished the show. He's like, "Hey, Danny Romero, how's it going? You know," it's just like, it's totally fake. Totally fake.
The shtick.
Right? Now, be that as it may, and this isn't the only thing. You know, you have a look at Jack Blood. If you have a look at if you Google Jack Blood, Alex Jones,
Mike Carroll. So I don't mean to cut you off, but you've interviewed Jack Blood, you've interviewed Mike Rivera, you've interviewed Sherry Kane, Dr. Leonard Horwitz, people who are actually suing Jones. Now, people also forget, I mean, this man starred in the blatantly Masonic film A Scanner Darkly. He's marginalized the truth movement in my eyes. He's sabotaged the pro-Second Amendment rallies in Austin in his past. I mean, really, this guy is a fear-monger extraordinaire, and he needs to be exposed.
Well, you know, and this is the difficulty. How do you expose somebody who controls the audience? How do you expose somebody who has the massive apparatus? How do you expose somebody who is more or less responsible for you waking up in the first place?
Right, that is the dilemma there.
Okay. He has stolen advertisers off of Danny Romero. He has stopped advertising silver products from Dr. Leonard G. Horowitz and Sherry Kane's Healthy World Affiliates program and replaced it with silver products that are under a patent by the Department of Defense. He right. has stolen a transmitter after coercing a partner of Danny Romero of him that was getting 50,000 homes. He was calling up Jack Blood and his friends and playing them off against each other. This is, like, Jack Blood told me that he was sitting at a table eating dinner with one of his mates, and his phone rings as Alex Jones saying that his friend across the table was demonizing him and going behind his back and doing all this kind of stuff, yada, yada, yada. And he goes, okay, Alex, okay, as he's looking at his friend. And then he hangs up the phone, and then his friend's cell phone rings, and it's Alex Jones telling his friend that Jack Blood's setting you up and going behind your back and doing all of this kind of stuff. He knows the New World Order tactics of divide and conquer. He knows the propaganda machines. He knows how it all works. And unfortunately, he uses it against us. Now, be that as it may, the fact that he's a liar, a megalomaniac, These are just my opinions based upon the evidence. If he's willing to come on and debate and things like that, I'd be more than open to it, because I really don't like judging people until I've gotten a chance to speak to the horse through the horse's mouth, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
But be that as it may, he has done more good for this truth movement and woken up more people than any other factor. Any other singular individual that you can point to that it had more influence and gotten more people off their ass and getting out there, you cannot point to anybody except Alex Jones. Okay, right.
Us broadcasters state him as an inspiration in a way.
Okay, now see, that's the thing. You've got to take the good with the bad when you look at Alex Jones. You know, and personally, every now and again, I still do listen to his radio show. And I noticed something yesterday, day before yesterday, when I was listening to a show for about maybe 20 minutes before my broadcast, and it was repetition. That's how he gets you. That's how he wakes you up, through constant repetition. Namely, the thing that I hear him repeating the most is, we can win. We can beat these New World Order globalist slime bags. That's the reason why he inspires people to get off their ass, because although he's talking about really, really scary stuff, he keeps constantly reinforcing the fact that we can beat them if we did something, okay? And that was a very important lesson for me to learn personally. And I don't know about you, but I found that the, you know, when you're trying to clear your voice, you're like, I found that actually the best way to clear your throat is actually to do an Alex Jones impression and say the word derivatives. You know, no, seriously, it's like, derivatives. See, throat is clear. We are now ready for air.
Derivatives.
Derivatives.
See, it's like broken frog or something.
It works perfectly. I don't understand the mechanism, but that's how it works nonetheless.
Absolutely.
Derivatives. We're gonna win against the globalists with derivatives and clear our throats. Once our throats are clear, we can win against the globalists.
The new world order is falling. We will kill them with derivatives.
You are the resistance. The derivative resistance. Yes, you are the derivative resistance. Clearing your throat.
Be sure to buy more derivatives on InfoWarsShop.com.
And more Defense Department colloidal silver that's patented by the Department of Defense. But yeah, this is...
Honestly, I don't really care. I mean, he's doing... Regardless of how, you know, crooked he may be as an individual, he's still doing a fucking community service. You know?
Oh yeah, totally. Whether you want to call him a good bad guy or a bad good guy, I don't know. But yeah. It's like, it's just the point I make about Alex Jones all the time. It's like, if you listen to, you know, to William Cooper, who was, you know, one of the people that basically predicted 9/11 months before it was going to happen, there's two people he spoke of as far as deception and not in such a fond light, and spoke of these two people in equal measure. The first one, Osama bin Laden, the second one, Alex Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I found that to be interesting. But anyway, you know, it's like, you know, you look at Alex and it's like, I've said many times, I don't care if he's a scumbag asshole that, you know, has his hand in all the pots, this, that, whatever. It doesn't change the fact that he has actually done a lot of good. Just like Vinny said, despite any of the bad, he's done more good than bad. And I mean, exactly. Hey, look at the historical figures that have done good. Like, okay, John F. Kennedy, he was a frickin' womanizer. Martin Luther King, he cheated on his wife, like, a lot. I mean, there's all sorts of people that are generally good, but have done all these scumbag frickin' things. But if they've done more good than bad, then the bad really doesn't matter as much.
Well, the thing is it's, yeah, it's a matter of choice, and number one, no person is not going to make a decision that they don't regret at least once in their life. You know, we all do things that we sometimes regret, you know, at the end of the day. You know, that's just part of the human experience, you know. And yeah, you know, when we're kids, we lie sometimes, or, you know, we don't do the right thing. You know, we don't give somebody a dollar back, or we do something stupid, you know, as a kid. But, you know, the difference between good people and bad people is, you know, you either learn the lessons of the past, you know, you make up for those mistakes and you learn why that's not right and that's not okay. And, you know, you make up for it, or, you know,
or not,
or not. Yeah. You just decide to be a scumbag and fuck people over. You know, and personally for myself, if I do become successful someday, I'm not going to go with that typical dichotomy like Vinny's talking about of being, you know, even if I become really successful and really
wealthy and whatever else.
Wealthy and whatever else, I want to be benevolent, and I want to teach, you know, my offspring to be the same way. You know,
I always money is just a tool. It doesn't. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make saints into demons, and it doesn't make demons into saints. What it does is it amplifies who you already are.
Mm-hmm.
That is what money does.
Well, with money, I want to get back to humanity. You know, I want to do noble things. You know, not to say that I'm a perfect person. I'm not. I'm fucked up, as you well know, very well know. You know, I've got my flaws, and I'm messed up like anybody else. You know, that's not the point though, but I want to do honorable things.
Ah,
I want to do things that are
the thing you did with the hooker the other night. No, I'm kidding.
Me and that Bill Clinton mask on.
Yeah. And you're all like, I'm having immoral relations with this whore and I really like it.
Or that time I got together with that ugly looking whore that looked like Hillary Clinton. Remember that?
Dude, I keep telling you, you were really drunk that night. That wasn't a lookalike.
Why do I still remember that?
What has been seen cannot be unseen.
What's insane, it can't be unseen. It was like a black hole.
Black hole in the email server.
I don't want to stick my input in there.
Clinton at server. Yeah, yep. You look up the host name data file and the secret server says Monica.
Monica, code name Monica.
Yep, the network name's called Blue Dress.
Blue Dress. in the Lewinsky computer hub.
And the SSID for the Wi-Fi is Dickens Cider.
Dickens Cider. Or Slick, one of the two.
I didn't inhale.
Yeah, and then the local area network LAN connection is, you know, Willie.
We already covered the LAN connection one. But anyway.
Oh, okay, whatever.
I said network name, that's LAN.
Yeah, network connection.
SSID is Wi-Fi.
Mm-hmm, yep.
Yep, but anyway, I mean, I just do my best to inspire people to be the change and inspire people to, you know, to know that it's okay for them to be themselves, which, you know, is why I've had to learn more and more to, you know, talk about my own flaws and insecurities and things like that, because it's like, you know, there's this illusion that, oh, in order to get up on YouTube and talk about stuff, you got to have all your shit together. You know, you got to be perfect and have it all figured out and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, well, if you could do that, how would anybody be able to relate to you? Wouldn't be able to help anybody. They wouldn't be able to see your flaws. They wouldn't be able to see your progress. They wouldn't be able to be like, oh, they can relate to how I feel about that. They have that insecurity too. They felt like that too, et cetera, et cetera. And if they know that you have that, and then they watch your progress of, you know, moving through that and overcoming that and, you know, can kind of get glimpses into your own personal journey, then that acts as proof to them, like, oh, well, if they did it, then I can do it too. Whereas if someone's up there acting all like they're God's gift to the fucking planet, like they're this guru that can do no fucking wrong, that's not relatable. Nobody can relate to that. That does not help anyone. It only helps, in quotations, people who are looking to justify their victimization and have a so-called guru keep telling them how the guru's better and how flawed they are, you know, addiction to victimization. But unless you're into that kind of fucking torture, then gurus are fucking useless. Anything else to add to that? We're almost at the 2-hour mark here, so I don't know if we should wrap it up or if there's something that you wanted to say before that, between Vinny making me look like I'm quiet and you going off to do whatever it is you did and playing this video, if maybe there was something you want to say that you haven't gotten the chance to yet.
Well, the main thing I just... if I haven't really said it already, is just that we are not powerless against the globalists. You know, Vinny was kind of going off on a little bit of a, he did that little side tangent of, you know, kind of, in my opinion, it was kind of like fear porn. And I'm just going, yeah, that's all true, but that doesn't mean jack shit. And I kind of also disagreed with him on the fact that you can't understand the globalists on all levels. I think you can. It's just you got to be willing to clear your mind and use fucking discernment and step back and stop and realize what you're looking at.
I think what he was just trying to say is that no human can understand everything about everything about everything because there's just too much going on.
Now that I agree.
I think that's what he was trying to say.
Well,
but
the way he was using it with his language was kind of...
I know.
He was making it sound more like, you know, in regards to the globalists. I'm like, oh, the globalists are easy as 1, 2, 3.
Well, like he said, he was in a bit of an aggro mood, so his brain was in kind of dichotomy mode. And despite being tired as fuck today, I'm actually in a pretty damn decent mood, so my mind isn't in a dichotomy mode. So I've noticed when I'm not in a dichotomy mode and somebody else is, there's like language context clashes. Like a motherfucker. Like, you know, the semantics just, like, gets things really fucking mangled. And, you know, when you realize it's happening, that's when it's best to just, like, stay calm, let them get their say in, and then after they get their say in, then just be like, okay, well, that's all well and great, and I'm not disputing that, but here's the point I was actually trying to make. And then they end up finding out that, oh, well, they halfway agree with you or sometimes fully agree with you, or maybe they still don't agree with you, but at least now they understand what you were trying to say. Whereas there's that false ego, mental malware impulse to just overvoice them and go, no, shut up, you're blah, blah, you're not understanding me, you're stupid. And so as you can see, I was just kind of like, all right, you know, let him go on his rant. And then after, you know, he had his say and felt, you know, that he got all that out, it's like, yep, I'm not disagreeing, but that wasn't where I was going with it. And then Denny's just kind of like, oh, you weren't. It's like, yeah, I wasn't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he but did that with me too.
Yeah. But I'm occasionally, you know, guilty of that as well. That's why I was just like, okay, universe, I get the point. Quantum mirror being a troll. Okay, I get it.
Yeah, exactly. But no, the main thing is just, you know, main thing I just wanted to throw out there is the globalists are pretty easy to understand. Just, you know, you got to step back, you know, let go of the malware and realize the weaknesses within yourself, turn them into strengths, realize what the globalists are doing. And just the main thing I really thought was kind of cool, you know, that he brought up was, you know, and yeah, focus on a specialty, focus on something that you have a passion about, that you're good with, that you know, and that you love. And just go for it, you know. Don't focus on something that you're not passionate about, because you'll just be more of a tool to the globalists that way. Focus on what you love. Drive yourself nuts. Yeah.
Protocol driven, always feeling that you're not doing good enough and yada yada.
Hands up, Jedi. Roger, 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 roger. Yeah, you don't want to be the droid. Don't be the droid.
Yeah.
You want to be the Jedi who, you know, or at least work your way there.
Just because droids...
I wouldn't say anybody's a metaphorical Jedi at this point. We're all, like, initiates.
Just because droid doesn't mean you have to.
Exactly. But anyway, yeah, that's my main point. It's just like, yeah, you know. And no, Vinny is correct if that's the context he was trying to use, you know. Nobody can know anything about everything and try to act like you know everything, because you'll just become one of them in the process. That is what we're dealing with.
There's actually a part of Vinny's brilliance that even he wasn't seeing, because he was in that mode where he's kind of like taking things, you know, worse than a chick. The brilliance about, you know, being an individual, doing your own thing, work with others, but not for others, because if there's no hierarchy, then you can't be shut down. Mm-hmm. And then I said, you know, and yeah, if everybody's doing their little thing at once, then, you know, that's how the globalists get taken down. And notice how that kind of like broke Vinny's brain for a second. Mm-hmm. He wasn't realizing that, you know, that is what he was saying. And it's brilliant. It goes to the old, you know, I mean, well, look what the globalists had done to us. The globalists knew that if you want to change all the fish in the ocean, you can't catch out every fish, you have to change the ocean. So in every way possible, they've changed the environment on us. And I'm not just talking about the physical environment, the emotional environment, psychological environment, business environment, everything that could be possibly be referred to as an environment, they've changed it up on us. And we can do that back to them, so that the way they're used to doing business just more and more is more, increasingly more incompatible with what we're turning the world into. That's why inspiration is important rather than trying to convince people of things. Because, you know, if you've got one little grain of sand, that's not exactly a beach. But if you've got all these grains of sand doing their own little thing all at the same time, then you've got the beach. So when you've got a whole bunch of people just doing their own little thing, there's a whole lot of everybody doing it. They're all working with each other, not for each other. They're all independent. They're all their own boss. There's no hierarchy and whatever. That makes a big difference. Like, you know, look at TSU. You know, every time we talk with Vinny, I always mean to mention TSU to him, because, like, you know, when he talks, he gets the word out to a lot of people about things. But, you know, especially the show tonight, I'm really thinking that most likely TSU would not be in his paradigm right now. Because, I mean, TSU is like the, you know, like a perfect, brilliant, genius mechanism for, you know, screwing over the, you know, the top 1%'s consolidation of wealth, power, and resources, sucking it, you know, from the middle class and bringing it up to the top. You know, this does the reverse. Hence why, you know, I made this thing here. TSU is not a get-rich-quick scheme. It's a weapon of war. There's a war being waged against you, whether you know it or not. TSU is the number one grassroots weapon against the globalist wealth consolidation agenda. Complacency is consent. Join the fight. And, you know, the reason why it's perfect is, like Vinny said, you can be your own one-man, one-woman individual thing. I mean, you're just posting on social media. They're sharing the revenue with you for it. I mean, you're one person posting, right? There's no hierarchy. There's no one you're working for that works for you. You're just doing your thing like anybody would on Facebook, on Twitter, whatever. But whereas Facebook, Twitter, et cetera, doesn't share, you know, their revenue with you, TSU or SU as it's called, does. And the more you grow your demographic, the more money you make. And, you know, there's people, you know, already starting to pull in, you know, a few hundred bucks a month and shit. So, I mean, this is like a great weapon against the globalist wealth consolidation agenda. But it's such a simple, empowering thing that it goes against people's belief systems in difficulty and misery and in, you know, bro, they've got nukes and smart meters and chemtrails, and there's no way to fight against that, bro. Well, that's, you know, again, when you've got that sort of an absolute belief system, it's like, yeah, all that was just said, that's all true. But when you've got that absolute belief system and you're totally locked into just that, someone comes along with a simple idea like, hey, see this simple thing? This could really make some headway. This could really help. The malware that the globalists have programmed us with, like Vinny said, we're all infected. None of us are immune. The malware kicks in and goes, no, that's not difficult enough. That's not complicated enough. That's not hard enough. There's not enough suffering and misery involved. So therefore, it can't work. But it's that exact thinking that we've been programmed with that our enemy uses against us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really interesting. It really is.
That it is.
Anything else you're wanting to say on this stuff, or have we about covered it, or?
I personally think we've about covered all of our bases here for now. You know, would like to at some point eventually do 2015 a look back, but.
Yeah, we'll get to it either this month or next month.
Yeah. But other than that, yeah, I think for this episode we've pretty much covered all of the bases and everything else. Anything else you want to call in?
Nothing I can think of at the moment. I mean, there probably are one, two, or three things I could go into, but my brain's like, you know, data access error, tired as fuck. So
nothing else I want to add to this circle jerk.
Yeah, you know, this circle jerk of narcissism.
Yeah.
With mind control pasta.
Let me stroke my ego. Stroke my ego.
Mind control pasta has you. As I commune with aliens, but don't worry, they are here legally. Anyway, guess that wraps things up. So everybody watching, whether you're watching live or at some point in the future, have a good morning, day, evening, night, middle of the night, whatever the fuck it is for you. Have a good one, whatever it is, whenever it is. And we'll catch you next time. You can hit the button, Dave.
I can.
Yes, I can.